Well, thank you very much, everybody, and good evening. And it was interesting, Richard, to hear, to be reminded about Ian's role, because obviously I think most of us in this room knew him. He wasn't a very exuberant man. He was a quiet man, a modest man. And so some of what he'd done throughout his life didn't actually come through to everybody, I believe. So it was very interesting to hear that. So, you know, I have to recognise my bad luck in actually having to give this lecture on this subject now, at this moment, when our state, because don't forget we're talking about cooperatives and the state, where are we now, when our state is facing its most chaotic, volatile, divisive and uncertain future for decades. So what I'm going to talk to you about tonight is my view. And I want to try and break down my talk into three sections, really. Where we are now in the United Kingdom, and I come to that from my experience in British politics and in European politics. Although I know a lot of faces in the room, there are some that I don't. And for those, can I say that I've been in the cooperative movement now for 35 years. I worked firstly in the cooperative movement. I came into it looking for a non-military and non-religious organisation for my children to join, and I found the Woodcraft Folk. I became a leader of the Woodcraft Folk for a short time in High Barnet, and I joined the cooperative movement at that point. I joined a cooperative society and became interested. You'll understand a little bit later how I came to know about the cooperative movement. But so as I went forward in my life, I want to try and talk firstly about my political life, then about my cooperative life and what I've learnt when I was Chief Executive of Co-operatives UK, then at the same time Co-President of Co-operatives Europe, and then, of course, when I left to become President of the International Cooperative Alliance, I worked very closely at all the senior levels with global institutions, the World Bank, the IMF, the United Nations, the G20, and so on. So I want to talk a bit about that and how all that has meshed together in now for me to give you some ideas about what I think we can do now as a cooperative movement to try and deal with some of the issues that we are facing in the United Kingdom today. So that's what I'm going to try and do. I didn't believe that I could come here and talk to you about this issue today without first and foremost talking and putting on record my own view and my sense of the issues of the moment. And I guess a lot of you in the room who know me will know from my career or from what I've been saying writing recently that I, of course, voted to remain in the United Kingdom, in the European Union. I'm not so keen on that. My children are going to Canada. They're thinking about going to Canada now. That I voted for the Remain side in last week's referendum. And I didn't do that despite my history. I didn't do that because I'm some sort of fanatical supporter of a European superstate. In fact, during my 10 years in the European Parliament, I always positioned myself as a pragmatic European. I.e., I believed very, very strongly, and still do now, in working together for the common good. And as a cooperator, it would be very strange if I didn't. Let me be completely frank. There was, and I'm sure probably still is, a federalist tendency running through European institutions, European politics, European parties. When I was in the European Parliament, and I left, of course, at the beginning of 2000 to go to Co-operatives UK, but when I was there, the 10 years I was there, 5 years as leader of the largest group in the Parliament, the European, as it was then, the European Socialist Group, I was a Labour and Cooperative member of the European Parliament. But there was a very clear tendency, federalist tendency, largely coming from some of the founder members, from the French, from the Germans, Luxembourg, those sort of countries that did produce a strong tendency to be more and more federalist. those countries, in all fairness, who had always suffered, particularly during the 20th century, with wars across their borders and all the destruction that brought. So you could understand it on that front. But also in the European Commission, there was a tendency from people being recruited to work there for a federalist tendency running through that. I believe very strongly in the role of a Member of Parliament as a democratic representative of the people that elected them. And I loved the period when we had constituencies. And my constituency was North London, the London boroughs of Barnet, Enfield and Haringey. And I loved to be able to say that I represented the area in London where my family lived and where my father was born. And my grandfather was a bus conductor out of Wood Green bus station. And it's still there. I think it's still there today, Wood Green bus station. It certainly was about 10 years ago. So for me, that represented something very personal, and I loved that period when you could actually feel you had people there whose MEP you were. And I think when we moved to a proportional representation and the list system, we lost that connection, and things have, without any question, deteriorated in terms of public perception since then. It was never good, and people did not vote in huge numbers for the European Parliament, and one of the issues for me was always that national governments, not just ours, whichever it was, Tory or Labour, but national governments always use the European elections as a test of the government in power nationally. It wasn't largely on European issues. It was about whether you want the Tories to stay in and this is our chance to give them a kicking. Well, we've just seen the effect of that in last week, referendum to some extent. But it always seemed to me and I always argued that we were missing the essential trick of actually selling what Europe could give to the people of this country. So as a Democrat, I always recognised that greater unity in Europe depended on the democratic will of the peoples of Europe. And that there was a very long way to go before that was secured, generations to go probably, before that was secured. Hence my identification of myself as a pragmatic European. Because, you see, I wasn't ever frightened of the concept of a united Europe. It never scared me. But I was clear that it was generations away at that time. And I think it's important to explain that as it impacts on my view of the nation state. For me, as a soldier's daughter, and I lived in Malta, Egypt, and Germany during my childhood in the immediate post-war years, I came to the conclusion at a very young age that peace was was to be prized above all else. And this was deeply ingrained in me, in my psyche, having been evacuated under military protection from Egypt during the Suez Crisis. Firstly, from the village we lived in Egypt, from the apartment we had in an Arab village, to a tented community protected by the British Army, and then being taken out under fire during the Suez Crisis. And then having been in a very tense Germany during the 1956 Hungarian uprising, when Soviet tanks moved to the East German border, and the British Army of the Rhine, as it was called then, and my father was a soldier in the British Army of the Rhine, was on high alert as war seemed inevitable. And I remember this because I remember that one year in November, bonfire night, which was always great on army camps for children. We couldn't have any fireworks, we couldn't have any bonfires, because there was a real pre-war alert going on at that moment. So all of these things impacted on my psyche as a child. So I've been temperamentally inclined ever since, and as I grew up, to the European project, given the underpinning concept of the founders of the EU was to bind European nation states together economically so they never could go to war again, because they would lose more than just lives. They would lose livelihoods, they would lose economies, and so forth. During my years in the European Parliament, I had the very great privilege to work with somebody that some of you may well remember, John Hume, who was the leader of the Social Democratic and Labour Party in Northern Ireland. And when the Good Friday Agreement for Northern Ireland was announced, I was working with Mo Molam, the then Northern Ireland Secretary, to try and persuade the European Union, to European Community as it was then, to try and support the Good Friday peace process. And I negotiated with the European Commission a 70 million fund for cross-community projects in Northern Ireland as the very first part of the peace dividend. And when Mo Molan came to the European Parliament to announce the terms of the Good Friday Agreement, she was able to make that announcement of the first peace dividend for Northern Ireland. And I had as the leader of the socialist group, I was the first one to speak in the Parliament, and I ceded that right to speak first to John Hume. John Hume, who was a member of the socialist group in the European Parliament, he was a very calm, quietly spoken man, John, very powerful orator. And as he was speaking about the way in which his people had suffered in Northern Ireland, and of course John was the person who first brought together the British government and the IRA to talk, and he was vilified for that for a long time and has suffered very badly, as did his family. But John was very grateful to the EU, and he said, and I remembered this and I've remembered it ever since, what the words he used: "The European Union is the most successful ever initiative for conflict resolution that the world has ever seen." And that stuck in my mind as a very powerful reiteration of what I believed was the underpinning of the EU. And I had the huge honour to nominate John for the Nobel Peace Prize, which he went on then to win together with David Trimble for the peace in Northern Ireland. Another thing that John said during that speech, to the heckling of the Reverend Ian Paisley, who sat with the non-aligned members and fascists and others at the back screaming across the chamber, but John, in his calm and confident way, said, "It's time that we shared our sweat rather than spilled our blood to build a life together." And all of these words really resonated with me and reinforced the value of the European project. And certainly as a mother, it was important to me. And that became even more important when I became a grandmother. I simply would rather that we sent our ministers to Brussels to talk and talk and talk again to secure a consensus, rather than we end up sending our sons and grandsons to fight, as my father did and my grandfather did before me. So is that idealistic fluff, as I'm told by some it is? Well, is it? Who amongst us can forget the horror, fairly recently, of neighbour murdering neighbour in the former Yugoslavia? And I was leader of the socialist group when a Frenchman called Bernard Kouchner, who was a founder member of Médecins Sans Frontières, rushed into the socialist group, which was in session, shouting, "They are murdering Muslim men in Srebrenica. At this moment, they are murdering thousands of men and boys." And of course, we know now, so sadly, that that was true. How can we forget the Middle East conflicts that have followed the Arab Spring, which was a moment, a very short moment as it was, of hope that there were going to be democracies established and the people of the Middle East would get their democratic freedoms? Or the Chechen or Georgian conflicts, or the standoff with Russia over both the Crimea and eastern Ukraine, or more recently, of course, in Syria. And all of these are in our backyards. All of them. None of them are far from us. The generational memory of the public is short, or perhaps I'm just getting old, actually. But it troubles me that the EU's role in preserving and building peaceful coexistence isn't valued more. And that concern has grown as, like me, I'm sure, you have been horrified at the growing attacks on minority communities in the UK since last week's vote. It's horribly evocative of Europe's not-so-distant history. But it's happening here, in our streets. And that's what's so shocking. So I'm a strongly convinced supporter of the European Union, flawed as it is, and imperfect as it is. And, you know, I was there during probably the time when the European Parliament was gaining more powers than it has ever since or before gained. I was there and I was instrumental in the sacking of the European Commission Apparently, we have no democratic rights in Europe, but the European Parliament is able and did sack the European Commission in the beginning of 1999. When I was leading the socialist group, and we took the decision to vote against the European Commission, and it was a socialist-led commission. But when we decided to vote against it, and I instructed my assistant to go and phone the Commission President's office and tell him the socialist group would be against, and 20 minutes later, the whole commission resigned. So, you know, it can be done. Democracy has been played out in the European Union. But it is flawed, and there's much more that can be done. So I am a strongly convinced supporter of the Union, but looking at it without rose-tinted glasses, seriously, is Westminster any better? The political debacle of the last few days is frankly almost too painful to bear for those of us who've been involved in British politics. And I believe that history will judge David Cameron harshly for bringing forward the referendum, not for the good of the country, but to resolve the increasing deep and bitter schism within the Tory party. And I believe that he will, his reputation as Prime Minister and as a politician will be tarnished by it. And of course, he failed in what he was trying to do. The issue of Europe will now dominate our agenda for years ahead. The problems that were exaggerated and misrepresented by the Tory, Labour and UKIP leavers will be a long time in discussion. Some may never get resolved to the satisfaction of the many who voted for Leave for some of those core issues that we all know about. What I think is clear is that we are now living through a sort of false period of peace until the British government or the Conservative Party has sorted out its new Prime Minister, leader and Prime Minister, and until that new Prime Minister activates the exit button with Chapter 50 of the European Union Treaty. But there are enough indicators already in our economy and in our life of what is to come when that happens, I think, to frighten all of us. We could see the disintegration of the United Kingdom if Scotland carries out its proposals for a second independence referendum. And if I can say, I think Nicola Sturgeon has played a blinder since the referendum. She has been extremely astute. She's capitalised on the chaos at Westminster. She's shown leadership. She's gone to Brussels. She didn't mind that she was refused to be seen by Mr. Donald Tusk. She's seen everyone she could see. She was out there about giving a strong, powerful message for Scotland. And I really admired her for the work she did over the last year, even if I don't necessarily agree with her politics and certainly would not like to see Scotland leaving the United Kingdom. But I think it's much closer than it was. We can envisage a collapse of the party political system that we've known and loved for generations unless the Labour Party moves quickly to restore stable and progressive leadership for the good of the country. Probably most terrifying for me personally, I must say, is when I look at the analysis of the referendum results and see the divisions in our society that are now exposed. Old and young, rich and poor, graduates and non-graduates, middle and working class, geographic differences. I think it's very, very scary. And I think we could, if we're not careful, see a right-wing government for decades in the United Kingdom, should particularly UKIP hold on to the working class votes that they won at this referendum and even, dare I say it, become the formal opposition at Westminster. And we can't, if the Labour Party isn't quick to sort out its problems, then there is every chance that they may be. What then, if that happens, for the rights and benefits that have been fought for by generations of Labour and cooperative activists? What then for the tolerance on our streets, of which we've been so proud and have lauded ourselves everywhere over many, many generations? I find myself, as a long-standing member of both the Labour and the Cooperative Party, I find myself fervently hoping that Theresa May becomes the Cooperative leader and Prime Minister, because the alternatives are frankly too awful, except with the exception perhaps of... What did I say? Conservative, sorry. Conservative. Thank you. Conservative. Except perhaps for Stephen Crabb, who looks, you know, pretty similar to... That's what happens when you don't follow your script, but start... Anyway, so cooperatives and the state. Which state, what state are we talking about right now? It's a very difficult moment in which to define how we as a cooperative movement go forward with it. So just let me tell you about how I came to know about the Rochdale Pioneers. I'm one of, as you already know, of the immediate post-war generation. And I'm one of those fortunate people, and I don't know if there are others in the room, who actually learnt about the Rochdale Pioneers at primary school. And I can still remember the teacher in an army school in Germany who taught us about the Rochdale Pioneers. And now that is amazing, because these days you don't get it anywhere in the educational. Well, you are now through cooperative schools, thank goodness. But we haven't had forever. And I still remember about the Rochdale Pioneers. Must have been a cracking teacher, because the story she told stuck in my mind. And I have a great belief in the value of cooperatives in the community and the role they play as part of the real economy. I fervently believe that cooperatives are a better form of doing business. And, you know, when I was president of the International Cooperative Alliance, it was my great privilege to be president during the International Year of Cooperatives. And I was invited by the United Nations, because it was a UN year, I was invited to open at the General Assembly, I was invited to open the year on behalf of the movement. Now, for somebody like me, who grew up with the United Nations, and who watched, you know, Nikita Khrushchev hitting the table with his chair in the UN, and Yasser Arafat, and all these Nelson Mandela, all these people, to speak at the General Assembly, at the podium of the General Assembly, in front of the assembled governments, was an incredible honour. We had been warned, actually, don't give it too much of a hype, because these years, you know, nobody really supports them. And only two or three governments will speak. It'll all be over in half an hour. So we had 300 co-operators in the public part of the General Assembly room. The Assistant General Secretary spoke, I spoke, and 60 governments from around the world stood up and spoke. It took 3 hours. Why? Because for those governments, they know only too well that cooperatives are a huge part of the real economy right across the world. And many of them wanted to get up because they'd been pressed by their own cooperative movement to do so. And they knew that the cooperative movement was important to their domestic economies. And as far as Europe is concerned, the EU had an agreement with all its member states, you don't sign these international years, you don't support them. Every one of them signed for the International Year of Cooperatives. Never happened before. And we were thrilled and delighted. Many of the EU governments stood up to speak. So the essence of our relationship with states is that we are a huge part of many domestic economies, and it cannot be ignored. It can be ignored at international level because we don't appear on the radar of politicians when they sit down to talk about the economy. Because the reference point, the business reference point for most politicians at that level is the international stock markets. And we don't appear there. So we're invisible to them. But when they come to think about their domestic economies, cooperatives are part of that. So the discussion in New York was very, very important in setting the scene that we did have something, we did have a year in which the doors were opened and we could begin to talk to governments in a different way about cooperatives. And everything since then has proved to me that we have everything to play for in building the cooperative family of businesses. When I first became president of the International Alliance, it was after a serious discussion lasting 4 or 5 years within the International Cooperative Alliance about whether the movement needed a global body. Why did we need it? Because what it had done for decades had been sort of like a centre of information and best practice. It had met three times, four times a year in some part of the world. Nothing happened in between. That in itself had been very valuable as the movement spread around the world. And don't forget, we're talking about a movement that's made up and owned by a billion of the world's citizens. And the largest 300 cooperatives are worth... I've forgotten the figure now. Ed, what's the latest figure? Okay. Shows I haven't. I've been retired since November. I think it's, what is it, two?
Over 2 trillion.
Over 2 trillion. Thank you. I'm nearly about to say three, and I'm sure you would have raised your eyebrows at me. Yes, 2.3 trillion. That's it. That's it. And so we're talking about a very large movement across the world, owned by a billion, and employing over a quarter, 250 million people, giving livelihoods to 250 million people around the world. So it's a huge movement, really reaching out into every corner of the world. But did we need a global body to represent us? One that was simply not doing anything in the global market, was simply meeting, going away again, and then meeting a bit later. So the aim was, and our intention was, and our result was, that if we didn't have a global movement, we would have to invent one. Because in a global market, you need a global representative body. So we set out to change the ICA. And I was elected, and the board that was elected with me in Geneva in 2009, set out to make a difference and to change the ICA. I saw my role as building our strength and cohesion so that our form of business and the social and environmental impact that comes as a wider package of our movement could be more positively and actively profiled around the world. So we could break out through this veneer of invisibility that we had and start to make waves in the global institution. Let's be frank, there are some problems in some parts of the world in the relationship between cooperatives and the state, particularly but not only in Africa, with regard to government interference. In many African states, governments have used the cooperative movement. They've used it in the sense that they like to control it. They want to appoint their friends to the cooperative movement. Of course, if it grows, then there's finances available. And they also use them to encourage people to vote for particular parties. That's not only in Africa, but it has been a particular problem throughout the last few decades in Africa. But there are some positive signs now in Africa. Rwanda, Ethiopia, Kenya, all of those countries are now beginning to develop a much more independent movement. In Rwanda in particular, there were some very encouraging signs of government producing seed corn funding and supporting the growth of cooperatives and then retreating from the cooperatives once it was up and running and democratically working under its own steam. So there are now positive signals coming from Africa. And, you know, I heard in the United Nations a very, very powerful African co-operator, Professor Suleiman Chambo, when he was reporting to the impact on Tanzania, his country, of cooperatives. And he said, and I quote, "As far as market development is concerned, it's been evident that agricultural cooperatives have been responsible for introducing the exchange economy in remote rural areas in Africa. By doing so, cooperatives have been responsible for developing modern markets in rural areas where the cooperatives provide a ready market for farmers' crops, but also absorb transaction costs, which would otherwise hinder small farmers from market and production integration." He went on to say, "Agricultural cooperatives maintain higher levels of income, making small farmers able to construct decent houses, send their children to school, and provide health insurance to sustain rural livelihoods. They also have the advantage of accessing cooperative education and business development capacity building. Cooperative education enables them to participate in democratic debates and exercising democratic principles and leadership training. This gives them the ability to become enlightened citizens, able to debate more effectively different political issues of concern to the community. But through cooperative education and practice, they also gain the skills of running business. That is why rural development would be greatly enhanced if people became members of agricultural cooperatives in general. How often I've actually thought of those words in the last week as I've listened to the quite woeful level of debate around the referendum. Why have we allowed the British public to become so ill-informed, so gullible in one sense, so open to manipulation by those with a platform and an overweening ambition? So back to the movement. The strengths of our movement are being recognised by the global institutions. It is slow, hard, frustratingly slow work, but there is progress. During the 6 years of my presidency of the ICA, we saw a discussion with the World Bank, with the United Nations in detail, with the International Monetary Fund, and latterly with the G20, the body that decides the direction of the global economy, and which is supported by a large committee of multinational businesses, which contained not a single cooperative. And we campaigned 3 years to get cooperatives onto that body. And don't forget, you're talking about the big businesses, the Amazons, the Microsofts, the Nikes. Should we have bothered? I believe we should, because our movement is global. And with the support of the Australian government, we were able to put the CEO of the largest cooperative in Australia onto the G20 task force and pull together at global level what we called our leadership circle. That's leading cooperators from large cooperatives in different sectors of the economy: agriculture, banking, insurance, consumer, health, housing, and so on. Put them together as his reference point. So he, sitting there as the largest agricultural co-op in Australia, had this reference group of cooperators around the world to whom he could ask on a trade issue, on a banking issue, on an insurance issue, and so forth. So we gave him his global movement. And he was able to make sure, with the support of the Australian government, that we put in some sensible, clearly articulated, evidenced information that showed what cooperatives could do in the economy. And from then, we went on to the Turkish presidency and are now active in the Chinese presidency of the G20 with strong support from our Chinese cooperative colleagues. So it is happening. Externally, we are beginning to hit some buttons. And of course, for me personally, one of the most unexpected areas was to be invited to the Vatican, as many of you already know, to go and talk to Pope Francis about what cooperatives were doing to end poverty in the world. And this man who, you know, I'd never been to see a pope before. You don't, do you? I mean, and although my mother's Maltese and I was baptized as a Catholic or christened as a Catholic, I'm not a practicing Catholic. In fact, I'm not really a believer at all. That's the truth. But I was invited to lead a cooperative delegation to the Vatican, and we were shown into the hotel where the Pope stays, because he doesn't live in the papal apartments in the Vatican. There must be a reason. But he lives in a hotel where other people are. And we waited in this basement lounge, looking at everything, walking around, looking at the pictures, and this little man walked in, all dressed in white with his Dr. Martin boots on. And he came up and he said, "Hello, I'm Pope Francis. Come and sit down and talk to me about how cooperatives can help us end poverty in the world." And we had 50 minutes, six of us, just talking to him. No notes, he had no notes, he had nothing. Just himself, no staff with him, and we talked to him. And he then wrote to the G20, talking about the need to put the human being back in the global economy. And he told us that his father, when he was a little boy, his father had collected him and his brothers, sat them down and talked to him about cooperatives, and that he had never forgotten that. So he's now got a bit of a reputation as the co-op pope around the world. I've seen articles referring to him as that. But support came from the strangest places. So the strengths of the movement are being recognised, and the movement now is more cohesive internally than ever in its history around the world. I've already told you about the leadership circle and what that's able to do for our representative on the G20, but that brings together 15 of the largest cooperatives in the world, largest and most successful, not only commercially, but but those who have the strongest proven record, track record, of promoting cooperative, the cooperative model of business. Then we have a cooperative round table, which is 100 primary cooperatives at national level. So far we are up to 50, but 100, building to 100. And their role is to input information and intelligence about what is happening on the ground, what they think the cooperative movement needs to do, and how the ICA can help that from the global level. And next week, 50 of those 50 will be meeting at Mid-Counties Cooperative in Warwick to talk about cooperatives and what they do next. That organisation, the leadership, the round table, the cooperative round table, those CEOs have actually initiated a global marketing campaign, which is what the video was about. And we're going to put it on in a minute. But this global marketing campaign is in recognition that they, the CEOs, believe what we need to do is have a public awareness campaign around the world. Not amongst, because cooperatives are so damnably good at talking to each other, but we are hopeless at talking outside to others. So they want us to talk to outside to others. So an American cooperative offered their services to put together a video for YouTube. Firstly, an American one, using American images. They've set up a template, they then offered it to everybody else who wants to use it, and they have customized it so that it's very easy for everybody. You use the same video template, the same format, but customize images to their own country, the same words in different languages, the same music, and it's now spreading around the world. We launched it. I was really proud to be able to launch what we call the What If video in Turkey, in Antalya, when I retired as president. It was the last thing that I did, was to launch the What If campaign. It's now growing, and Mid-Counties has launched theirs, and we're going to show it to you. It's being shown now on television in
Central West.
Central West and Thames North, in those areas. I think that's right. Ed, you know about it as well. Do you want to just say?
It's in the George Coronation Street, not being the gap there. So, but you have to be in the right region.
Yeah. It would be great to do it nationally, but it's money. Mm. But I thought you might like to see it. So how do we put it? So this is now, we launched it in the US version, a Hindi version done by our Indian colleagues, a Japanese version, and a Spanish version from Argentina. And some of the images were very, very powerful. The Japanese cooperatives during the tsunami and the earthquake in Japan. Indian cooperatives and what they're doing for communities right across India. So very powerful stuff, and all using exactly that format, all using exactly the same words with just their own images. And they will be meeting this year to this next week, and I'm going to have dinner with them to see how they move it forward. So I should be pleased to meet up with those people who are leading that. And I think within 2 weeks of the US one going on YouTube, it had 50,000 hits. So it was a very powerful message, and we hope it's going to spread around the world. So the movement is now coming together, not just to talk to ourselves, but to talk to the public. So this is a crucial moment in the history of our state, but not only our state. We've all seen and heard the wider disaffection in many parts of Europe, not just with the European Union, but with their national political elites. The Nordic countries, for the first time, feeling the serious threats from far-right parties. Germany, France, the Netherlands. The different political revolutions in Greece and Spain on the back of their economic crisis and evidence of political elite scandals and greed. And then, of course, there's Donald Trump. Donald Trump piling up support on the back of exactly that same disaffection and dislocation in communities, a sense of injustice, unfairness, and an increasing anger that probably is the most threatening thing of all. And, you know, everybody in the US is saying that this is the election with the worst two candidates ever. And the danger of that, and Hillary Clinton, obviously I guess most of us would want Hillary Clinton to win, but I have some anxieties about it. Well, I have some anxieties about Hillary Clinton and some of her, but I would far rather she won than Donald Trump, believe me. But what we're all experiencing is the result of the degeneration of politics on the back of the ascendancy of capitalist businesses and the primacy of the profit motive. And there is a space and an opportunity for something different. And this is the time for cooperatives to advocate for our role in building better communities, in our ability to bring cohesion, fairness, equality, and make it possible for everyone to participate and engage in building a better world. The movement can show the way. Someone somehow has to express a different view, promote a different vision of the life chances and how they can be developed and grow in the 21st century global economy, because that's not going to go away, and how we can make it work for local people in local communities. It ought to be us, and it ought to be now. Only by working together, though, can we actually bring that vision to life. Only by ensuring that all cooperatives walk the talk and are actually real and true and legitimate cooperatives can we prove our way of doing business is a better one and prove its benefits for local people and our local communities. It has to be now, it has to be public, and it has to be genuine if we are together to prove that there is an alternative to the collapse of local communities, the disaffection of local people, and the rise of those who would try to manipulate those anxieties and concerns for their own vested interests and singular political motives. It can be done. We can build a new cooperative relationship with the state. And why not here? Why not first in the United Kingdom, where cooperative was given to the world? Thank you very much. So now it's your turn. Questions, queries, comments? Please do, anything you like.
Can I just bring one...
I should start by saying, because there are people here we don't know, would you like to say who you are?
I bring one sentence.
Who are you?
John Cornish.
You have to do it in an orderly way and stand up as well. So I'm John Cornish, and I bought a second copy of a book by a bloke called Clement Attlee. And in here, and I just wanted to read the first sentence, although you might actually enjoy the second sentence, of chapter 6, the socialist objective. He says, the aim of the Labour Party is the establishment of, with capital letters, the cooperative commonwealth. Now that was 1937. I was told at the Coker's Cove branch ward meeting on Monday evening in the Beckenham constituency that Captain Dennis Healy proposed the motion that proposed the nationalisation of the economy rather than the socialisation of the economy. And that is a project of mine to follow up. And so I wanted to congratulate you on pointing to the fact that our movement, the Labour movement, standing on its three legs of the trade unions, the Labour Party, and the cooperative movement, since 1937 has given up on public education. And therefore, we have the vacuum into which Farage, which basically is Cable Street Part 2, has walked. So that's our beacon, and that's why I'm here at the UKSCS meeting.
Thank you. I think there is a real role that we can perform now, actually, and nobody else is going to do it. So, but it does.
We are the people we've been waiting for, right?
Yeah, exactly. Go out and do it, will you? Anyone else?
Gareth, a member of various cooperatives. I didn't know John was going to mention the Cooperative Commonwealth, but when I discovered the other day I couldn't buy Co-op 99T at my local mid-county store, I came to the conclusion that we'd totally failed. That would never have happened under Bob Bilton's watch when he was chief then. We'd lost the Co-op. Quite decapitated. But joking apart, in terms of the message that you've been talking about and that other cooperatives globally are challenging in terms of the G20, it seems to me part and parcel of some of the things that perhaps John was just talking about, where we haven't expounded
exactly
our message. Let me give an example of, it seems to me that some cooperatives, let's call them the cooperative group, in recent years has been focusing upon corporate social responsibility type things, which everybody does. How do we get back to the fact that, my understanding of the Rochdale Pioneers was setting up in 1844 to raise money to change the world, rather than, you know, do all the kind of green things that people do now. How do we actually get back to the campaigning front that's actually necessary to actually challenge those things? And if we sit back and do Me Too CSR type things, we'll be no different from the big retailers, the big businesses, which do that because they've got lots of money to do it. What is it we need to do within the UK to actually re-engage with business and politics in that regard?
Well, you know, it's a very good question. I think we the movement have to take responsibility across the globe for having let this all go, actually, because, you know, we have not sold our movement outwardly, and like, you know, we've been around in the UK, the co-op movement, a long time, and everybody in the business world goes through cycles of good times and bad times. We know that. But we let go of the discussion about what cooperatives were for. When you look at some of the original TV adverts for cooperatives, which the Co-op College has, when you look at them, you see they're not talking about the price of baked beans. They're actually saying, and this is your cooperative, to the lady walking along to the Co-op store with a great big perambulator. I mean, these are the things that mattered. They were theirs. It belonged to them. And we've let go of that. So when the CEOs got together to talk about how we market cooperatives, the first thing they said was, before you do anything, you have to have a public awareness campaign. You have to lift the level of public awareness about what a cooperative is, because everybody thinks it's just another shop. Okay? So you have to change that. You have to change that. You have to make it about communities. You have to lift that level of awareness, and then you can build onto that. Hopefully, people will then revert back to local cooperatives and start thinking about what they are. And we can see the diversity in Co-op UK's annual report on the economy, the cooperative economy. You can see the diversity of our movement in the UK. You see it's, what, 33 billion to the British economy? But where's the recognition of that? And this is the problem. So we have to start shifting it from the grassroots as well as tackling it at the top. It isn't one thing, you know. We have to have a public awareness campaign. We have to drive it up amongst local communities. But we also have to speak to politicians at the top level and persuade them, engage with them about what cooperatives can offer. And particularly now, when there's so much disaffection about how you can use cooperatives to bring communities back together, how you can use them. It's about what we did with Northern Ireland and the peace dividend almost. We got funding to create cohesion amongst communities. And there was a challenge in Northern Ireland, but maybe to try and bring communities back together through working together to create community to fill community needs in a way that they have it under their own control. It could have a very significant impact. When you look at what Germany's done with their energy in local communities, local villages, taking control of their energy supplies, they know about the cooperatives in those villages because they own their electricity supply. You know, it's that sort of thing that we need to do. Sorry, you had a hand up there.
Yeah, I work with schools, so I worked for about 6 years in Tower Hamlets, and I did a lot of work with Gregory over there with school kids setting up their own co-ops. But the thing that inspired me was not once the small co-ops in Tower Hamlets inspired me, but
yeah,
the co-op itself. And now I live in Leiston, I was on the East of England's Members' Education Committee. And to me, I've never been, that inspired me, the Education Committee, not now, you know, 10 years ago. I have not been inspired by a single cooperative store in this country. I shop in Tower Hamlets. None of it. What inspires me is the fair trade movement,
yeah,
you know, the stuff we can use with schools, the history, what are in his school,
yeah.
You know, and the history of cooperative schools, Alexander Bloom and his cooperative school in East London in the 40s. But no, I just see a corporation, to me they don't express the value.
Well, I know that Bob's busting a gut to get in, but before he does, I just want to say to you that I understand that, and what we have to do is to look at not just. You have to look at the co-op movement because it's made up of many different co-op businesses, not just one. And a lot of the new wave, new generation cooperatives that are being established now are very powerful because they're going to be the co-ops of the future, if you like. So I think you're right about some of the newer ones, the younger ones, being very, very inspirational. But I'm going to let Bob talk about the consumer movement because I know he wants the most...
likeness of your name.
Oh, yeah.
So it's Michael Newman.
Thank you, Michael. But I'm sure he's going to say you haven't been to one particular shop, which is sensational.
Oh, good gracious. you seem to know. I'm Bob Burton, formerly Chief Executive of Oxford, Swindon and Gloucester, sometimes known as the OSL Good Society. but I'm their friends. I think I'd like to make a comment that links your contribution with Gerard's, and also something that Pauline said, because, I mean, you know, I've been around the consumer movement for many years, and I've seen so many societies do things that are not cooperative, and it's exhausting, it's demeaning, and it's defeatist. And Pauline used the phrase, we have to walk the talk. Mm-hmm. And we do. Because if we are just as you said, just a me too, you know, corporation, then we haven't got a right, actually, to be saying some of the things that, you know, as co-op activists we want to say. So I think I believe, and being a curmudgeonly old git, as it were, this is what we have to do, and it's about, and I believe that members have to make it happen in their societies, but that's not easy at all, and particularly in the cooperative group as it now is, which is a very top-down organisation. But we have to support and strengthen, for example, the Members' Council and people on the Members' Council who want to save their co-op. I mean, the most recent example, for example, the most recent disgraceful thing that the group has done is to decide to abandon the use of dot co-op. And that is an abdication of their responsibility to the international cooperative movement and to, if you like, the growth of the internet age, where what we want to see is co-ops having a coordinated identity in the internet. It's absolutely disgraceful, but it's happening. And the one hope I can offer to you, as Pauline predicted, is there are some societies that are trying to do the right thing. I mean, for example, I think the attention and the effort that East of England have been putting into on local food is to be applauded. And another example I could offer you, the best thing you could do is take a day out to the Cotswolds and visit Chipping Norton, where a number of years ago, about 15 years ago, the society then did something quite distinctive in building a new store. It refurbished the buildings to the state that they were originally intended to be. It spent much more money than it needed to do, adding those little touches. And it did a number of things. There is, incidentally, if you do visit, one thing that there was some surplus space which OSG basically did a very benevolent deal with the local history society. The quid pro quo was there had to be a cooperative segment in that museum, and there is. And it's recently been extended, the store, and it's got to be the best, most impressive, most idealistic consumer cooperative store in the UK, and it will cheer you up if you go and see it. The struggle we have is to replicate it in other parts of the country and in other societies. And as things stand, I'm afraid to say, there would not be a cat in hell's chance that the group would do anything like it. If we want to appeal to people and to convince them that we are different, cooperation is a better way of doing things, then we have to show them. And it's no good just saying it, we have to show them.
And that store, by the way, it has the strong support of the local MP, one David Cameron.
Ed. I'm actually due to go and see that store on Wednesday morning, so it'll be the first time I've seen it.
With the CRT, the round table.
So I'm Ed Mayhew from Co-operatives UK, and one of the things I've got the pleasure of doing is being able to go and visit co-ops around the country that are inspirational, but they are inspirational in their own way, and they do vary, they do differ. You know, I go to Edinburgh not so long ago, the Edinburgh Bicycle Club.
Oh, yeah, that's great.
And it's inspiring because they say they put an owner in front of every customer. So actually the inspiration isn't Seven Principles, history, the like. It's actually the person that you're dealing with, because there's something quite different. And actually that, I think, is where the consumer cooperatives, because they're larger, because if you're in a competitive market, you do always tend to end up looking a little bit like your competitors, because there's lots of me too you have to match in a lot of areas, as well as needing to be different where you can, is actually the disengagement of colleagues. This is something that goes back in terms of a historical debate about who owns cooperatives, should it be the customers, should it be the staff own rights, within that. And I think one of the good things that the largest co-op group is doing is actually starting to engage with the people who work in the stores, because that's where inspiration, I think, needs to come, and I think there's a real journey to go on there. I think also inspiration can come from the products. The co-op group store that I'm inspired by is in Manchester, actually, where there's a big poster of a good friend of mine called Alex, who is a fair trade banana farmer. I was involved in the early stages of the Fair Trade, but on the Fair Trade Foundation board for a while, and Alex was on the board as well, so we had to. So it was amazing to just sort of see him, and you could think, oh, there's Alex, there. But actually, it's the products. Products tell a story, and that's where, although not the baked beans, actually, maybe the baked beans. How are the baked beans different? If you can get your baked bean, what cannot be different? What could you do that can't be different? And I think one of the things that really does inspire me in consumer co-ops is the wines. It's the co-op. And the consumer co-ops are the world's biggest fair trade wine distributors. And there's some fabulous kind of wines that are there. So although the cooperative movement in the 19th century was all temperance and not much alcohol, now we're all in co-op pubs and fair trade wine. It's got a real.
Thanks, Ed. There was a gentleman at the back, yes.
Alan Spence. One of the things we have to get into, of course, is the production of things, because the retail element, they sell only things which have been produced elsewhere. And until we get into the production side of things, of course, we won't have a balanced economy or begin to move forward in a decisive sort of way. Yeah. One of the things which we can do is to explain what's happening in Spain on the Mondragon, because they do have a very successful production element which also extends into education and also retail. So it's a rounded sort of project which takes place there. But there's very little information available inside of the UK on that side of things. And so I think we have to do it. What I've suggested is that we should call a meeting of the TUC, the trade union leaders, with someone from Mondragon to explain in detail how they've gone about different things, explain it so that they can communicate and encourage trade union movement and the different unions to get moving on the production side of things. The other thing is that as a town planner, one of the things I'm particularly interested in is the Garden City movement. Because if we look at the Garden City, which is Letchworth, all the people, the majority of people involved in it when it started in 1903, were all co-operators.
Yes, they were.
And that was their model. Now, it's true they didn't actually use Robert Owen's New Land Act model, but that was at the back of their mind, because they didn't want to use Robert Owen, because they say there's been so many failures over the past century of the efforts which the Robert Owen and all the people associated with, the dozens of settlements attempted, and they failed. So they never used his word in a sense, but it was based on the ideas of all that took place in the 19th century. Well, we have to get back, I think, to the Garden City idea, because if we look at 1945, in a sense, we've got to have a reformation of the New Town Planning Act, which took place in 1945, because the 32 new towns that the Labour government started were all based on the principle of the Garden City idea. And the intent was that as each one was completed, it would be transferred to its local authority. And as they owned the land on which their factories, their housing, whatever it was situated, they would get the rent income with that particular local authority, and from that be able to build up and develop themselves. Just as Letchworth
yeah.
does, I might say this,
well, in Garden City,
Letchworth
yeah.
still owns its own land, 4,500 acres, and every year the people who live there have a general meeting to decide on what they should do with the surplus income that comes out of their estate. I might add it to it, it's not a share out. It has to be spent on infrastructure and things of that kind. So I've said this reformation, let's put back on the agenda the Garden City idea, and let's take over again where it was left off, when unfortunately it was stopped by the Labour government in 1976.
Well, thank you very much for that. I know there's a lot of intermingling between the Garden City initiatives and the co-op movement, but then co-operators were in most of the progressive initiatives that took place over the last 200 years. So you're right. On the Mondragon thing, I must tell you that Mondragon is working very hard. They have a representative in the United States. And their representative in the United States is working very hard with the trade union movement on building cooperatives for the migrant community and people with very on very low pay and they're doing a fantastic job. They've created hundreds of cooperatives servicing those people, and they're using a Mondragon model. And the International Cooperative Alliance works very closely with the Mondragon representative in the US to help push that along. It's very inspiring when you see some of, particularly the women, who are being supported to find their way to onto the economic ladder through a cooperative and so forth. So you're right, it has a lot to offer. Okay, Mondragon is a Spanish cooperative in the Basque country. It's been hugely successful. It was started by a priest, actually, in a very poor area. And they've built a huge movement, which is not just primary cooperatives. It's expanded to production cooperatives. It has a university. It has an IT hub, which is partner is Microsoft. And it's a vast, almost like a whole city on its own, the Mondragon development. It's very, very interesting. You should there are often visits from the UK to Mondragon.
The best book is Jobs of Our Own by Rose Matthews, if you want to read about Mondragon. It's a bit old now, but it's an extremely good book.
Yeah. Thank you. Over the back there.
Actually, I was laughing when the Mondragon reference came up, because I was supposed to be at Mondragon this week, showing them how to do self-managed learning, which is what I focus on. But one of the things are interesting.
Who are you? Yes.
My name's Fred Garnett. I kind of do social improv and various stuff, live in Lewisham, and I'm also working on developing participatory cities, which is an evolution of the Garden City. But the thing that I was interested in, and I was going to raise it earlier, is that one of the things that Mondragon did is put producer co-ops at the heart of what they do. And the problem that's been in the UK is that the web said that we shouldn't have producer co-ops, we should only have consumer co-ops. And so since 1901, it seems to be that the labour movement's had a problem that it only promotes consumerism and managerialism. And it's lost that organisation around work that we actually need now. I mean, working on a European project called The Origin of Spaces, which is looking at creating third places, neither private sector or public sector. And the irony is that so the Basque people are a partner in that, and so are people in Croatia. We actually have a situation that participatory governance and self-organisation is being led by our Croatian and our Basque colleagues, and we are putting that much into it. We're looking at kind of social entrepreneurship, which I see as a kind of capitalist form of cooperation.
Yeah.
You know, so we've kind of lost that lead, and people are looking to other areas. So, I mean, actually, the reason I'm here is I want to use some of your materials and feed it into that European project, because people are really interested in our history, but we actually don't represent it very well currently.
Exactly. There were others. Glyn, at first, and then...
My name's Glyn Thomas. I come from the cooperative housing sector. I'm on the board of the London Federation of Housing Co-ops and the former vice chair of CDS Co-ops, which some of you may have heard of. Now, cooperative housing in this country is a comparatively small sector. Mm. Look across the board into Wales, of course, the government there is very sympathetic to cooperative ideas and has done a tremendous amount to promote various kinds of cooperative enterprises in housing. This went down the Barney Commission. But I don't think we should get hung up on the word cooperative. There are all sorts of organisations, community-led organisations, co-housing schemes, bona fide co-ops, where schemes where people take over their blocks of flats, the whole range of things, common hold schemes, and we should be promoting them. Now, if you approach the co-op group, get a stone wall. And a few years ago, we approached the co-op group about an empty bakery in South Epping-on-Sea. This was a huge building with a very large car park.
It's still there.
I know it's still there. And I don't know what's in it now, but the ground floor was too big even for the shop that was there, and the rest of it was storing Coca-Cola and toilet rolls. The back was a huge car park, which they subsequently sold a part of, as a co-op group, to a local estate agent, who then passed it on to Barrett's, and it's now a luxury home. We approached them from CBS at that time to do a comprehensive development with a new shop facing up to the roads that the present shop doesn't. Nothing doing. They weren't at all interested. So I'm afraid the big consumer organisations have not come up with the goods. but I don't think that's something to worry about too much. Really genuine cooperatives are community-led. They're grassroots organisations. They won't survive as genuine cooperatives unless they have the support of local people, and were preferably formed by local people. So I think this is something we ought to be promoting and developing, where it's all small scale. It's not, you know, at the United Nations, it's just small stuff. You know, it might be the one I went to in Merthyr Tydfil, or something of the order of 40 flats. Mm. That's the level where it works, because it produces a direct daily benefit to the people who are living in these places, and they contribute to it. So I do think that we all get too grandiose in our, you know, building the cooperative convent. I've been in the cooperative movement for 30 years, and no one's ever explained to me what it is. So I'll pass that, possibly Catalonia, which wasn't the best example.
It's all right. Just go to cooperativesocialism.org, you'll see it all there.
I waited to be enlightened. Right, so we need to concentrate on smaller bodies, the big consumer, if they feel like it, you know, very sceptical, could give seed code, you know, help to finance. But it's not going to be done from above. Any cooperative scheme that's going to work, it's got to come from the bottom up.
Thank you very much. I understand what you're saying about the small, and that's what I talked about cooperatives across the world being active in the real economy, being the absolute backbone of the real economy. And those are, on the whole, the small primary cooperatives who are sort of below the radar. And it's absolutely right, I agree with you. But I'm not as cynical as you about the large cooperatives, because you may be right about the cooperative group now, but the cooperative group isn't every single cooperative retail in the UK, and I think we should be a little bit more gracious, because a lot of the money over recent years that has helped to build smaller cooperatives has come from the consumer movement, and we need to be aware of that. They can't do everything, and some of them won't do anything, I agree with you, but some of the others do a lot, so I think we need to recognise that, Glyn.
I didn't mention energy co-ops, for example, mid-counties when they finance the wind farm, which I'm a shareholder down near Swindon. That's a very good example.
There you go. But they're not the only ones, and that's not the only initiative.
Yeah. They are a minority. Let's not kid ourselves. They are a minority. Unfortunately, it should be more, and people should stop fixating upon what the shops are doing, where they've got selling various products, and start thinking what the wider idea of cooperation actually is.
Well, that's fine. And I think we have talked about the real economy in recognition that the cooperatives, every sector of the economy, cooperatives are active in it.
Two marginal years of co-op called the Bannister House Energy Cooperative. They've got together and they put PV panels on top of council housing, which is run by Hackney Homes. And that was done as a local initiative, and it is successful and will probably spread out more in other parts of Hackney, except that the law is ludicrous. They generate their own electricity, which they then have to sell to the big six. Their own electricity, they have to pay six times the price for the electricity they're actually producing themselves. And the government really intervened. If they really want to promote small-scale energy costs, something's going to be done about the
Yeah,
problem.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, thank you very much.
Sorry,
Richard.
It's all right. Who are you, Richard?
Richard Bickle, various cooperative roles, including being an elected board member of one of the larger retail societies, Central England. But what I wanted to pick up was, I was very pleased that Michael mentioned earlier on the work that we did on the Education Committee as the former Ipswich and Norwich Cooperative Society, now East of England. Because I think in 20 odd years of having elected positions in the movement, that was probably the proudest one I've occupied. And I think we did really important and pioneering work, keeping alive a tradition of cooperative education, which included things like running choirs and dancing classes at a music school, but also reached out into some pioneering work for schools and young people. And I can remember, well, I'll just pay tribute to the fact that Michael is the only person I can ever remember who came forward for election because he saw a poster in his local shop calling for nominations. And we got the nomination form and we thought, who's this man? No one knows him. There was this, you know, there was all these kind of frantic phone calls internally to work out who you were. And then we met you. Anyway. But there was a point when the kind of two key officers at the time were Mike Faulkner's secretary, who's still secretary of the Society, and Pam Walker, who was the education officer. And there was all sorts of interesting stuff the Society did. There was work the Education Committee did. There was the community dividend scheme, whereby we still quoted shared numbers in those days. It was only about 15 years ago, but you know, if you remember, you quoted your number at till. And if you wanted to give your dividend to the community fund, you could quote share 660 instead of your own number. And there were a number of other things that Society did, just because that was what you do when you're a co-op. But we didn't get any credit for it, and it wasn't strategically driven. And Mike and Pam got together and started properly cataloguing and reporting on this good work. And we chose to create a language to describe what it was we were doing and why we were doing it. And we came up with this, or they should say, came up with this concept of creating a culture of cooperation, or fostering a culture of cooperation in the communities in which we trade, which, you know, I've since tried to introduce to colleagues at Midlands, now Central England Co-op, because actually, I think it's no good blaming the government or blaming other people or, you know, blaming our members and our colleagues for not understanding what it is that we're about. I think we've actually all got to be creating that consciousness all the time, and that's got to be strategically managed. So if you're doing, you know, corporate responsibility type stuff, for goodness sake, do it in a cooperative fashion. Don't say it's a capitalist plot, let's not do it, but do it in a properly cooperative fashion and talk about it in cooperative language. And I think my concern about your 100 great CEOs thing is that it worries me that certainly in the movement in the UK, I mean, there are better stories to be told in North America, as I understand it, but in the UK, we haven't really done any strategic development of cooperative management as a particular management discipline, really since the 1960s. I mean, there was a scheme that sort of struggled on, run by the Co-op College, and the last person who went through that was Ursula Lindbetter, who's now chief executive of Lincolnshire. She finished that in 1981. And I think a lot of the story of the kind of decline and fall of the cooperative group, you know, to the point of being very, very close to complete collapse. I mean, admittedly, you know, somewhat recovered now, thank goodness.
As a business, not as a cooperative.
Story, I think, is about lack of leadership.
Yeah. Okay. Well, we all know there's a lot more to do. I'm not saying that everyone's perfect by any means, but we have to try and improve the level of our cooperativeness, particularly in the consumer movement, which has suffered. And we know, and Ed's very good at marketing new, inspiring cooperatives amongst, and perhaps not even so new, but ones you find that are doing good stuff in communities. Those two have to go together, because they're all carrying the cooperative name. One of the key things about the cooperative movement is that when one goes bad, we all take a hit. And that's what's happened with the cooperative group. I can tell you that the British movement is not exactly suspect, but I know when I left the ICA, people were very anxious about the British movement. So they need a positive role model from the UK, and we hope that's what they're getting now. But it's been very difficult to try and hold on to public perception when you've got something that went wrong as badly as that did. And even now, it's not great in terms of its cooperativeness. It's commercially, it may be succeeding, but its cooperativeness. Just one more, and then we'll...
So, John Knott, I work for Co-operative, the Cooperative Journey on People's Organisation, but I kind of want to take my working for a charity hat off and go back to the bit you were talking about at the beginning of the quite bizarre situation we find ourselves in at the moment. Because, as you've made it really clear, the cooperative movement is not just the retail movement or the agricultural movement or the cooperative societies. It is a wider educational and political movement. And there is obviously, with any challenge, an opportunity to be seized. And I just wondered what you thought, with your experience of UK politics and European politics, of the movement which there seems to be at the moment for some kind of cooperation between political parties who were on their own side to challenge the the prevailing culture of frankly racism that's coming from some of the working parties. And now I know that there are some very initial moves being discussed about whether the parties might work together in the snap general election. I just wonder whether you thought, is there scope for the Co-operative Party to be leading that kind of cooperation to try and create the kind of legislative and regulatory environment, whether it's that will foster that cooperative spirit that we're talking about? Because my first involvement was in small worker co-ops supported by a local authority funded CDA. And that's, we know the examples of other countries where the state is very supportive of the cooperative sector, and that's clearly a long way from where the current government's agenda is. But I think there's an opportunity for doing things quite differently.
Well, on key issues that apply to all our communities right across the country, I can't see any reason why political parties can't cooperate on anti-racist activity and the attacks on ethnic minorities of all sorts. I don't see why that should prove a problem. I don't see why you have to have discrete campaigns for each body. Why can't you work together collectively to make that stop and to bring back some sense of cohesion? The Co-operative Party, of course, is politically aligned. It's got an electoral alliance with the Labour Party. So I don't think it's going to be foremost in pulling together a cross-party initiative. And first of all, we've got to get leaders in the major political parties. But honestly, those sort of campaigns have always been run on a party basis. But I think it's reached such a pitch, and such a dangerous state that I don't see why together there can't be party agreement on that has to stop. But I don't see it happening, and I don't see the leadership for it at the moment, to be perfectly honest. I'm getting the nod from Ian that it's time to stop. So sorry, Marilyn. Thank you very much.